All right, so
there we go.
Okay, so we want to get into all the Google Shopping insights and good stuff, so I'll keep the introduction short. Some of you already know me. As I mentioned, I'm John. I've been both sides of client and agency relationship. I've been in digital marketing for 8 years and Finch with the programmatic paid search and shopping agency. I think that'll do for now. And again, if you have any questions, please use the control panel to ask away. I'll pass you guys over to Logan and he'll take the wheel from here.
Yeah, so as I mentioned before, my name's Logan. I'm with Datafeedwatch. We're a feed management service allowing you to send your data feeds to 1,000 plus channels in 50 plus countries. And I'm gonna talk today about how to optimize your campaigns with your data feed, so optimizing your data feed. So to look at the agenda for today, we're gonna go through some of my data feed optimizations, then I'm gonna pass it over to John. He's gonna take you through some success factors of optimization, and then we're gonna look at a recap and ask some questions. So getting started with data feed success factors. So how do we optimize our Google Shopping campaigns with starting at our data feed? Well, the first thing we've gotta do is we've gotta meet the requirements. We've got to start with the requirements and be able to submit to Google Shopping and not get disapproved. So that means that you have to have, typically you're going to have some kind of tool in between your shop and Google Shopping, something that integrates with your shopping cart. And then you want to make sure that you have all the required fields that Google wants, like ID, title, description, and what have you. Once you hit that baseline, then we can start looking at maybe some of the common mistakes that we see merchants making. So a lot of the mistakes that we see, well, we see wrong product URLs. We don't see very good images used, and categories aren't categorized properly. Maybe pricing is outdated. But one that's really complex that we see really often, and it's not that well understood, is GTINs, and that's your product identifiers. So GTINs are your global trade identification numbers, and they're required by Google, but not every time you don't have your GTIN are you disapproved by Google. So what are your GTINs? Well, in North America, they're your UPCs. In Europe, we use the EAN, and if you have custom products, then you'll not need a GTIN, but you'll use like a field for identifier exists and you'll say that it's false. So you don't need them for custom products. But why do you need GTIN? So I mentioned that you don't always get disapproved, but Google does require it. Well, the reason that you want your GTIN is you can actually get better ad placements. So you can get placed in the searches as top or best, which ultimately improves click-through rates. So that's kind of what we see on the mistakes side, which we could spend an entire master course on optimizing for mistakes. But I wanna get into the real nitty-gritty, and that is optimizing your data feed. So optimizing your data feed, we can do a number of different things. You can add missing fields, you can have multiple updates, but today I wanna focus on our product titles and our adding more information. So let's start with our product titles. Let's say that you have a product where the product title is 501. 501's not a great product title, but if your brand is Levi's, then Levi's 501 becomes a pretty good product title. You can see that in the little example that we have on the side here. So in order to get your product title to go from 501 to Levi's 501, you gotta start combining different fields. So in our example, we've got Levi's 501 men's blue jeans size 32. And by doing this, you end up increasing your click rates and being able to be seen for your ad because you start matching your product title to the way that your customers are searching. So let's see this in practice with one of our clients, Zoop Gear. So Zoop Gear actually took this whole theory one step further. They went and did keyword research. So they originally had product titles where it was, as you can see on the screen, Wilson Classic Baseball Gloves, and they added the model number, which probably wasn't the best item to have in their product title. So when they went and did their keyword research to try and optimize their product titles, they found three things. They found that their customers or potential customers were searching for what hand the glove went on, who the glove was for, whether it's for a youth or adult, and what the material it's made out of. So with that information, they went and restructured their titles to then match the title structure we have below, which is Wilson Youth Leather Baseball Gloves Left Hand Throw. Result, 250% more clicks. That means more traffic to their products with more clicks. Now, this is an extremely labor-intensive optimization. So we suggest doing it for like your top 15% of products. But if you want to get crazy, you can go ahead and do it for all your products. It's up to you. But 15% of your best sellers is probably a pretty good place to start. Now, what's the other way that we can start optimizing our product feed is by adding more data. What kind of data can we add? Well, you can add things like gross margins, your price rank, seasons, keywords like Zoop Gear just did. And basically what you're gonna do is you're gonna take your standard feed that's coming from your shopping cart and merge it with a second feed that has your additional information. As long as you have some kind of common denominator in both those feeds, like a product ID, then you can go ahead and zip those two files together, and then you can start using that data for all sorts of crazy things. What would you want to use this extra data for? Well, our client Nextail, who's a UK company doing over $200 million in online revenue alone, brought in margin. And so why did they bring in margin to their data feed? Well, before they brought in margin, they were bidding a single bid across a number of different products. So they had one product type, football shoes, and they were applying the same bid across all of them. Now, they were overbidding on the football shoes that had low margins, and they were underbidding on the football shoes that had high margins. So they broke out their margins into four categories: low, two types of medium, and a high. What that allowed them to do was decrease their bid on their low margin products, increase their bid on their high margin products, so that they weren't losing money on the low margin and they were able to show more often for the high margin. What you can also do, so that's one way to use the extra information for your products, and they did that through custom labels. Another way you can actually use custom labels, kind of going on a tangent here, is you can basically start creating custom labels for just about anything. And our client Adidas does this for type of sports and type of garments. And what that allows them to do is just basically segment your products in any other way that you think fits your business. Okay, so those are two data feed optimizations you can run through. So now, how are we going to improve our ROI? Well, there's a number of different things you can do. You can do the custom labels like we just discussed. You can run promotions, you can bid on product types, or you can do one of the simplest things and just remove unprofitable products, which is what I want to talk about next. And simply, you would just exclude products, maybe on price, where your price is $10 and it just doesn't make sense to bid on those products. Or since we're kind of in springtime here, in Frankfurt, it actually snowed last week, so I'm not so sure we're quite in springtime yet, but you may want to stop advertising products for winter. So you can start excluding seasonal products and start only bidding on products for summer. So just a very simple way to exclude your unprofitable products and boost your ROI. So just to kind of recap on these few items, the tactics that we discussed today is, first and foremost, we've got to get more visitors. That's through our through our product titles, maybe your images. Next, you've got to start optimizing your bidding. We talked about that through our custom labels. And the next is just cut the waste. So that's removing unprofitable products and making sure that you're only bidding on your best products. With that, I will go ahead and turn it over to John, who's going to take you through the success factors of optimization. And just one last point. If you have any questions from the couple of items that we went over, just stick them in the questions section and we'll go ahead and answer those at the end.
Thanks, Logan. Some great insights there. Excuse me. So let me start by saying, I often ask clients, what do you want in return for the money you're spending on buying clicks from Google or Bing? And you may be intrigued to hear the range of answers I get back. But ultimately, if I keep asking questions, it comes down to one thing. People tell me they want to earn more money for their company, which makes sense, right? At Finch, that's what we specialize in. Not maximizing impressions, likes, clicks, or engagement. It's all about hard financial returns from your AdWords shopping campaigns. With that in mind, I'm going to cover five topics, and they are attribution, the models available to you, and what we found to work best. Business KPIs, are you measuring the right thing? Data-driven bid adjustment, remarketing lists, and finally, campaign structure. What's the best way to lay out your product listing ads for performance? You may have all seen this before. This is the typical example people give for attribution, how you associate value along the customer journey. In this example here, the question is the striker that touches the ball last, the scorer gets all the credit? Or does the winger who crossed the ball deserve credit? Or even the goalkeeper that started the move? Personally, I prefer the example of someone having a few drinks and a night out, just blaming the last Jaeger bomb as the reason for their hangover instead of acknowledging the previous six drinks beforehand had significant impact on the result. Bottom line, why this is relevant and the reason we look at attribution model is it allows us to look for a relationship between spend and revenues. Simply put, attribution is all about finding relationships that you can replicate to make more money. So here are some of the choices that Google made available over a year ago, and these are available to you right now. What I find when I chat with clients about attribution is someone in the company chooses one model based on opinion rather than data. No one challenges this because they don't fully understand attribution modeling, which results in a campaign strategy of eeny, meeny, miny, mo. So look at the two extremes on each side of the slide and imagine how different the max CPC will be based on these choices. The left one is the most conservative and often has a higher percentage of branded clicks versus the most aggressive model on the right. We usually use the position-based model to get the better mix of the two. You have to note as well, these models are very hard to implement and measure by themselves. But when you add other areas I'm going to talk about into the mix, it gets very complex fast, which is a great reason to handle this programmatically. Okay, this should be the starting point for every digital marketing team strategy when it comes to search and shopping. What are you measuring for success? CPA, our cost per acquisition, is the one highlighted here. It works for businesses that have one product or have many products with the same price. So each conversion is worth the same. What we're seeing here is the wrong use case for CPA. Both products have vastly different values and thus have a serious impact on revenues. So where you have many products with different prices, where each conversion is worth a different amount, but importantly, each pound of revenue is still worth a pound, you need to figure out what is the cost of revenues that works for you. Let's use the example of the USB cable. For every pound you spend in your shopping campaign, you're getting £24 back. That's a cost of revenues of roughly 4%. That means that the iPhone 7, with a cost of revenues of 4%, you will be willing to spend £30 to get a return of £759. This is extremely important, and I hope it makes sense. If you have any questions about this, please ask away, and we'll go into more detail. Bottom line, by optimizing the cost of revenues, you ensure your best-selling products are not hamstrung by budget. The next step for this retailer to really get a competitive advantage in their shopping campaigns is to move to a CPP, our cost per profit. We consistently move clients from a cost of revenues model to a cost per profit model once we have collected enough data on conversions, and this is something that we can do on each product. I hope to plan that on another webinar later on. Okay, now we're getting into the nitty-gritty. This is really easy to find out and extremely common practice I find when reviewing an account with a client. As shown on the left of the slide, they look in their analytics and see the percentage of traffic by device. From that, they allocate budget accordingly. However, once I bring them into their AdWords account, look at conversions per device type, cost of revenues associated, we find that traffic volume doesn't correlate with conversions. With further research, we find that in your product catalog, that small and large ticket items may be converting differently on devices. By using the levers at the ad group level, you can make bid adjustments per device. You can get more granular by having less products per ad group. This is a huge opportunity for you to get a competitive advantage, but obviously this will be paralleled with the increase in complexity of managing your campaigns. Not only can you adjust bids for device type at the ad group level, but also for audiences. When it comes to remarketing lists, I consistently see in clients' accounts one of three things. A, they might not be remarketing at all. B, the client will have a lot of audiences with no bid adjustments. Or C, they'll have the same bid adjustment regardless of audience, just setting like a generic bid of 25 or 50% bid adjustment across the board. We need to realize, and I'm sure you appreciate, that user profiles can be extremely different regarding value. So let's take a few examples. So here's an example of user profiles. We have your new visitor, your returning visitor, product in the basket, last visit 7 days ago, customer, returning customer, 30 days after conversion. Each user profile's propensity for a purchase varies from the previous site activity. It's criminal not to use this data. Now that we know that each visitor profile has a different propensity to convert on your site, what does the bid adjustment look like? Here it is. You can see on the left of the funnel the conversion rate, then the site action, and finally the visitor profile bid adjustment. Armed with this information, when someone enters a product in Google, you can be far more confident that you're getting the revenues you want before the bid in the auction. Now we're taking a look at the different campaign structures. In a lot of cases, you have to bundle your products in ad groups within campaigns. This naturally will result in neutering performance, as one product is often outperforming other products with the same ad group. So the question is, how do you get around this so you can focus in on your cost of revenue strategy that we're talking about today? Well, structure your campaign to have one product grouping per ad group. Next, build a product grouping as granular as maintainable. Then build product groupings based on performance or related products. Like a good example of this would be by brand or product type. The best practice here is to split out products with many conversions into new groups and bid individually. What we do at Finch is build shopping campaigns with one ad group to one product grouping to one product. This in turn enables more accountability to your cost of revenues goal. However, note that we internally group products based on one or two attributes, whether that be brand, category, product type, or custom label. And just to note as well that the reason we run audits before we start talking to a company is because we can isolate products and see the performance against the cost of revenues goal. This instantly shows if there's potential for growth. Okay, this is an eye-opener. This is what organizing one product listing ad, or PLA, to get all the data unique to each PLA looks like, so that you can track performance accurately in order to predict what a click is worth at the real-time auction. Here I'm looking at four examples of what a unique click profile is for four different PLAs. just take a look at all the variables that are building up the profile that set the value. These are only a few, and just imagine what will come down the line in the next few years to make the click profile more complex. Then the question is, do you want to manage this evolution programmatically or with people in spreadsheets? And this is the challenge that you and your competitors are facing at the moment. Ah, I love this table, as it really gives you a better picture of what you're dealing with on a daily basis within your shopping campaigns. Let's say you have 500 products in your catalog. Each of these 500 variations come from three different devices, mobile, tablet, or desktop, who each have different performance and different value to you. You now have 1,500 variations to manage. Each of these 1,500 variations also have different user profiles. Example, new user being on your homepage, being to your product details page, abandoned the cart, or completed the purchase. That's five additional profiles that perform very differently and impact the performance. And now you have 7,500 variations from 500 products, and each of these clicks has a different value to you, depending on the predicted ability to earn you profit. Each of these clicks has a unique profile. That's what you're dealing with. And finally, similarly to search, you can add negative keywords to your shopping campaigns. This will help ensure you're driving the right relevant traffic to campaigns and that you're telling Google which product you don't want to show for a specific search string. Now I'll hand you back to over to Logan, and we'll go through the takeaways and have a wee Q&A.
Cool, thanks, John. Wow, so we've had quite a bit of information today. So hopefully you guys found a lot of value there, took some notes maybe, think about some things that you can do today and implement them. We talked about feed quality, first and foremost, just meeting your feed requirements. We looked at some optimizations, some campaign structure, how to attribute your advertising dollars, who on the football team gets the credit for the goal, optimizing return on ad spend, looking at some bid modifiers, and then your negative keywords. So with that, we want to open it up for some questions. If everybody can just put some questions into the questions on the webinar, that'd be great, and we can get going with some of them. I will go ahead and get started with the first question we have, which is, how do I optimize thousands of SKUs? This is a good question. So you may have 500 products, you may have 500,000 products, and whether you're doing a few SKUs or a lot of SKUs like this question, it takes a little bit of a strategy, and that strategy is looking through all of that data that you have and kind of figuring out what a good, from our perspective, from a feed management perspective, what your mapping is going to look like. So how are you going to send all of this data to Google Shopping? And really that comes down to looking at spreadsheets or at Datafeedwatch, we've got a feed review that can help you do that in an automated fashion. But it's taking a look at what you've got, what data you have, what data you need to send to Google, and then creating a mapping strategy for that, like combining your product title information. John, did you see any good questions?
Yeah, and just to add, and hopefully it came across in the audit or in the webinar there in the slides, for us it's all about granularity as well. So it's about breaking down your ad groups into, or your products into ad groups that are manageable. So therefore, you can really associate a return on ad spend to the specific product and keep it accountable to it. So that would be the main thing. And that's the reason I think programmatic is really important in this area. So I have a question here. My search campaign performs better than my shopping campaign. Should I stop my shopping campaign? I would say absolutely not. Your shopping is visible also in search. So remember, by having your shopping campaign up and running, you're taking an additional spot in the SERP. So therefore, what we see is we see about a 60% chance of being seen, a greater chance of being seen, and also a 30% chance of actual conversion. So as long as you're keeping your shop and running and just making sure you're focusing in on your cost of revenues goal, I wouldn't recommend stopping your shopping campaign. Logan, any thoughts there? Any questions you picked up?
Yeah, this one's quite common. We get it quite a bit, and it's the what's the difference between Google product category and product type? And simply put, Google product category is how Google categorizes products. And product type is how you categorize products. So what does that mean? Google product category is Google's taxonomy. Product type is how on your website is structured, or your shop is structured on your website. And so you can do different things with each of those, and you want to map your product type to your Google product category. And so you find basically what matches best between those two things. And by doing that, you actually get your products put into the right categories. So the searches that people run are more relevant. And when people run searches in those categories, your products are shown. So that's kind of how we see those two working together, or the differences.
Okay. And I see another question here. My Google shopping results are good, but how do I make my ads stand out? Do you want to take that one, Logan?
Yeah, so this one's a bit, this one's tricky. There's a lot of components to this one. Really it comes down to what work have you already done on your data feeds? And I'll take this from a feed management perspective. So it depends on what you've already done to your feeds. What is your vertical? And then how do you fare against your competitors? So you can do things like, if you haven't done much in the way of feed optimization, you can go through the product title optimization like we discussed before, and you can match that to your particular vertical. Or you can run promotions to help out with the your competitiveness on your different channels. Or you can do product reviews. So you can aggregate your ratings and put your ratings in for Google product reviews to kind of help with the validation of your products and your store. So that's kind of how we see those working together.
And all I would add there is make sure the pictures are good quality and that the shot is unique. Because visuality is pretty important there.
Yeah, that's a really great addition, John. Thank you.
And then I have a question here. Some of the products aren't performing. Should I just show the products that are performing in shopping and remove the others? Well, I believe all products should have the chance to compete as long as they're coming in at your cost of sales or your cost of sales targets. Just make sure that the title and description are usually the two most critical things to have, and then brand. So that's all I'll add to that. Let me see. Is there any other questions you see there, Logan?
Yeah. How important is price in the success of my shopping campaigns?
So I would say that in shopping, it can become a comparison website, but it's not critical. One thing to note as well, that it can be a race to the bottom when it comes to adding price. So it's really an option up to the retailer themselves.
Interesting. Okay, that's good to know.
Okay, and let's see. And then just one last thing as well, guys. You can see on the slide there that we're showing that Finch are running an audit, so please use that if you want to see exactly how you're performing within your shopping campaigns at the moment. And we can also look at search. And Logan?
Yeah, so we've got one other question here, and it's for brand new accounts and what and how you should manage a brand new account. And really, my suggestion here would be to get all of the basics correct, meaning you meet all of the feed requirements, you're adding some additional information, maybe you're adding color if you don't already have color, and then you can take your again, we come back to the product title, because product title is like one of the most important pieces of your ads, and that's matching your product title for customer searches like Zoopgear did, or it's combining different fields so that you can enrich that product title, and really getting the basics right. And we actually use we did a data feed optimization guide a while back that goes through all of these, all this information to get you basically from just starting out with shopping campaigns and feed management into becoming an expert. So we take you through the entire process, and really you can go through all sorts of different hour-long, week-long seminars on these types of issues. Do you have anything to add for somebody that's just starting out, John?
Yeah, absolutely. Just on the feeds, it's extremely important to make sure they're up to date, and specifically when you're dealing with niche markets, because as well as that, when people are searching, they might search specifically for an ID because they know exactly what they want. So we need to make sure that all that information in the description, the title, the product ID are all updated. As well as that, what we find is we can pull that information into your search campaigns as well. So therefore, you're crossing off both. And as well as that, if you do have everything up to date and you have a feed running into your shopping, we're able to actually stop an ad running once we see the products out of stock. And once it comes back in, we can rerun it again. So it's really important to have those foundations there. And there's lots of there's lots of blogs and information and resources, both on Datafeedwatch and Finch's website, how to do that.
Yeah, and I actually just put the link to our the guide that I mentioned in excuse me, talking about these feed optimizations in chat, so you guys can have a look there. And it's our ultimate guide to data feed optimization that kind of runs through the details of how to implement a lot of this stuff.
Cool. One thing I'll mention now as well, have you any more questions there you want to answer there, Logan?
I think that we've got it pretty covered.
Cool. So I'll just say, you can see both Logan and my email address there. So if there's anything more detail you want to go into, please shoot us an email and we'll get back to you straight away. And I'd also just like to thank you for taking your time out early in the morning, whether it's Barcelona, Germany, UK, wherever you're based, to say really appreciate you coming online. And I hope that you found that insightful today.
Yeah, thank you as well. And yeah, feel free to reach out to either myself or John with any further questions. And we hope that you guys have a great rest of the day and you can take some of these tactics and start implementing them this afternoon.
Exactly. Best of luck, guys, and take care.